ठीक है,
नो प्रॉब्लम नो प्रॉब्लम,
विल स्टार्ट, विल स्टार्ट, थैंक यू। Okay, Sanjay, if you're ready, we can start.
Yeah.
You know, friends, it's a great day for me because here is a student of mine, Professor Sanjay Kumar, and whom I met in the early 1990, right, Sanjay?
Yes.
From DU, and that time Sanjay had, you know, lot of hair. Now I see his hairline has thinned a lot, and Sanjay looks very mature. So I think for me as a teacher, it's a red letter day that here is a student of mine and I'm presiding over the function. And I'm very proud of Sanjay because Sanjay taught in colleges, but later he became a name globally because of his intervention in election forecasting, result forecasting. You know, he's the one who is one of the fundamental pillars of Lokniti. He's the one who managed CSDS. I think you are still the director or somebody else has taken over?
Somebody else has taken over now.
Yeah, so you just, you know, manage CSDS, you know where all the big names were there. So Sanjay is also a big name. I am very proud of you, Sanjay. And I am thankful to you, Sanjay, because you agreed to give address us at Vishwabharati on a topic which is very close to my heart and also close to your heart.
Yeah.
And I know this is a very busy time for you because I'm sure you are engaged in many election survey, especially in these states where elections are being held, including West Bengal. So we'd like to hear something, you know, a very interesting, exciting, bordering on the prediction of the election results. So all my colleagues, you know, many of my colleagues have attended. The students are also participating in this discussion. And after your lecture, we'd like expect you to, you know, respond to some of the questions. Yeah. And as soon as you say that you are tired or you get exhausted, we'll stop. But so long as you want us to carry on, we'll be happy to ask you questions, because it's very difficult to get Sanjay. Sanjay is so busy, so tied up with so many things, especially now. So that way, I think we are very lucky, Sanjay, to have you. And I am really grateful to you that, you know, you immediately responded to my request, which I sent an email. And, you know, Sanjay, it's a part of university lecture series. You are the 31st. No? This is the 30th lecture. And I started after I joined Vishwa Bharati in January 2019. And today is the 30th lecture. You know, we had Lord Desai, we had Lord Bhikkhu Parekh, and next week we are going to have Arvind Panagaria. So, you know, there are many. And then we had Brian Hatcher, who on Hinduism. So, then we are going to have Bob Korodonsky. We had Professor Thomas Foge. So, you know, this is a series I'm trying to get my friends, my colleagues, my students to enrich us, you know. And this is a kind of platform where we can, you know, have interaction, not only with our colleagues, but also with our students. So I think, Sanjay, with this brief introduction, but I don't know, I don't want to talk much about you, because then everybody will say, because you are my students, I'm really biased. But, you know, I'm telling you, Sanjay is a wonderful human being. And I keep bothering him with all kinds of data. And Sanjay simply, you know, just said, the moment he receives my letter, I get the data, because I also work on election-related studies. So many of my books, you know, you'll find Sanjay's imprint, you know, because Sanjay gave me the data. And also, sometime I had discussion with him that isko kaise socha jaye, aap batao, aapne kaise socha hai. And Sanjay wrote many books, you know, two important books on Delhi elections, I remember. And these are very useful books, and I'm sure with these kind of elections coming over, Sanjay's intervention and Sanjay's, you know, kind of, you know, idea of how to read an election will help us to understand the very critical election in West Bengal. So Sanjay, with this note, I keep the floor open to you, and you please start.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Professor Bidu Chakravarti. It's a great honor for me. You have taken names of the people who have delivered lecture in this series. So it's a great honor to be part of this lecture series. And it's an honor for many things. Professor Bidu Chakravarti has been my teacher in the department. And we had not only a teacher, kind of a guide also. I always consulted him, even if he was not formally my MPhil or a PhD supervisor. But I had very good relationship with Professor Bidu Chakravarti. So his invitation matters to me a lot. And the Professor Bidu Chakravarti did mention that I responded immediately because of several things. One, I have a very good relationship with him, a different kind of a relationship, not only a relationship of student and teacher, but also this is a topic which is very close to my heart. And I would love to say something meaningful in the next, say, 35-40 minutes. So let me begin, and I will try and share a PPT. I may not be saying very exciting things which you may be expecting me to share, say, but maybe in the question answer session I would try and be cautious, but still try and answer some of your questions, because I think I would need to abstain saying things about what is going to be the electoral outcome, because of the ban by Election Commission. That, and people know that I do polls and I am doing post-poll survey. So if I say some numbers, if I say some data, this would be seen as releasing post-poll or exit poll data, which is not allowed during the period of campaign. So let me try and do something meaningful in the next 35-40 minutes. So I'm just trying to share the screen. Can you see the screen now?
Yes.
Okay. So, as the topic suggests, understanding election and experiential perspective. So, how do we understand election? This is the broad topic on which I am going to speak, and these are the contents. Essential question: why should we understand election? That's the basic question. Why should we understand election? What is there to understand elections? And there are two broad techniques of understanding elections, what we call the qualitative method of understanding elections and the quantitative method of understanding election. Feasibility of CATI and CAPI. And what is CATI? CATI is computer assisted telephone interviews and computer assisted personal interviews. And why should we attempt to understand election? Why? What is the utility of understanding election? I'm starting with a quote which is by Rabindranath Tagore. And this is important because I will finally try and connect this quote with the overall, what is the utility of election surveys and why, how we should read this data. So we read the world wrong and say that it deceives us. Facts are many, but the truth is one. This is by Rabindranath Tagore. And remember, mark these words. We read the world wrong and say that it deceives us. And this is connected to how do we read these opinion polls and later on try to correlate the opinion polls with the final outcome. And then we come to the conclusion that opinion poll was wrong. It is not the opinion poll which was wrong. I think we, most of us, read the opinion poll incorrectly and then tend to conclude that the opinion poll was wrong. Actually, the reading of opinion poll was wrong. And I will try and give details about that why I said reading of opinion polls are wrong, but we tend to conclude that the opinion poll was wrong. Now, essential question, the two big question: why should we attempt to understand election? What is the utility? And how should we understand election? These are the two big questions which I am trying to focus on. And let's address the second question first, which is how should we understand election? What are the methods? The two broad methods of understanding elections. This is also the method in social science research. So understanding elections, understanding politics is also under the ambit of social science research. At least in political science, people do a lot of election studies these days. So the two broad ways of understanding election is what we call qualitative method of understanding election, and the other is the quantitative method of understanding elections. How does a qualitative method work? Generally, it is about detailed interviews. We can call it ethnography. We could do the study in a constituency. One could do interviews of political leaders, sitting with political leaders. But it's a qualitative approach, case study, studying one constituency, one rally, maybe rally, following one political leader. So these are different qualitative methods of understanding elections. In the quantitative method, it is about survey. So when we use quantitative method, it is about survey. The survey could be of three kinds. Physical survey. Physical survey means actually going to different places, actually meeting people face to face with a questionnaire, asking them questions and noting it down systematically. A systematic sampling, systematic asking the question, and systematically collecting the data in a physical mode. CATI, we could also use, people are also using CATI, which is computer assisted telephone interviews, which is to say the investigators, people who want to study elections using a quantitative method, the survey method, they don't travel to different places. People are sitting in one room, one hall, few rooms. They are using telephones and the computer. So they are dialing people in different locations, and the numbers are collected through different modes, maybe from the service provider. So numbers are collected from them through a randomized method. Some voters are selected. They are called by over a telephone. And whatever data is getting, whatever interview gets conducted over telephone, those are fed into computer. So that's another way of, and these days, lot of people are doing this. And we don't do computer assisted telephone interviews. we always do physical survey. We send people, people travel to different places, meet people in the face-to-face situation, use a questionnaire, a physical questionnaire. Still, we use the paper and pencil method to ask question. But CAT is being used in a very large way, in a very large manner to do interviews. Hybrid. And why do I call it hybrid? Some people mix it. You know, some computer in some interviews on the telephone, some physical interviews, different kinds of method of data collection. And that is why I'm calling it a hybrid method of doing survey. So these are different methods of data collection in a quantitative method. And in a plain words, in a simple word, we can call the survey method. So survey has become an important tool to understand election. I'm not saying that ethnography or a case study is not an important tool. That's also an important tool to study elections. But largely these days, when people talk about numbers, party A is winning 100 seats and party B is winning 150 seats. These are all generally derived from a quantitative method. Though I must say these days, there are people, there are agencies which are trying to come up with numbers even without using a quantitative method, using a qualitative method. But that's not the right way, because one should, if you come out with numbers, and that's the utility of a quantitative method, that's not the business of a qualitative method. Now, moving on from the strength and weaknesses of these two methods, the qualitative research methods, what do we do? What are the strength and what are the weaknesses when we apply a quantitative, qualitative method of research to understand elections? Researchers can go to a set of constituencies, prepare case studies or ethnographic account for documenting their experience and observation. So it's largely about experience, observation. You are meeting people, not in a systematic manner, not with a structured questionnaire, but you keep meeting people. And these days people say, we were trying to understand the mind of the voters. We were trying to understand the body language, the psyche of the voter, the atmosphere. So these are all, these can be done only in a qualitative method of research. When you are doing ethnography, just sitting, talking to people, not using any structured questionnaire. Studies involve conducting detailed interviews with local leaders, other stakeholders, studying speeches, manifestos, and published election material. So this is what is how a qualitative method is employed to understand election. You study speeches. People follow one political leader or many political leaders, studying speeches. These days, people even don't go for speeches. They take, you know, clippings from the newspaper, clippings from the TV shows, and they try and study those speeches, manifestos, understanding the campaign method and an electioneering process in a particular constituency, recording incident of violence and malpractices in a particular constituency. So these are different methods which will all come into the big basket, which is a qualitative method of understanding elections, where there is no systematic data collection. And when I say systematic, there is no systematic sampling, where to go, how to go, and how to interview, how to collect data in a fixed format. There is no fixed format. People collect data in the way they want and in the way sometimes it is required in the field. So you have the liberty to move around even in with regard to how you ask question, how you record. Record means sometimes you might record. In your phone, you might take notes, you might take some photographs. But in the quantitative method, when we are doing survey, these are not the techniques which are employed. I will come to that later on. But let me focus on qualitative method of understanding elections. So these are the different methods of understanding elections, which comes into the basket of big basket of qualitative research. What are the advantages? The advantage is, it is an ideal method for nuanced understanding on one particular thing. Just to give you an example, do the speeches, the big public rally, does it impact voting preferences? So, or TV debates. Does the TV debates influence voting behavior? So if it is on a very particular, very specific topic, then a qualitative method of research is very important tool to understand the nuanced to understand elections in a very nuanced manner and with great detail. So one can use this technique to understand elections in a very deep manner. Limitations. And what is the limitation? But using such methods like studying campaign, one particular constituency, it is very difficult to generalize. And this is what I said earlier, that these days people are using qualitative method and they come up with numbers. I think this is the limitation. If we are using a qualitative method, which generally means studying a very particular, one particular aspect of election or a couple of aspects of election, whether it could be about manifesto, TV debates, election rallies, one particular constituency, one political leader, based on that, a generalization is not possible. Generalization means coming out with numbers, which party is likely to win how many seats. And certainly one cannot come up with an estimate of which party is likely to get percentage of votes. Can only be a quantitative method. So this is the limitation of a qualitative research. While people these days are using qualitative research and coming up numbers, which is not the scientific method, which is not the scientific way. It's not the means are not justifying the ends. If you use a qualitative method of understanding election, one should not come up with numbers because it is very difficult to come up with numbers. You might
কতজন এসছে?
Can you hear me now?
Yes, now I can hear you. Yes.
Yeah. So now moving on from qualitative to quantitative research. And quantitative research, as I said earlier, it is largely about survey. So there are two different kinds of model. Model A, duration constraint. When do we do the poll? So one, we call it opinion poll or pre-poll survey. Pre-poll survey, much in advance before elections. Like in Bengal or in other state, you know, if we look at Pondicherry or Kerala or Tamil Nadu, which went to poll yesterday. But polls were coming in the month of February, January, February. Bengal is going to poll in 8 phases. But we got some polls, we saw some polls in the month of January, February, even in December. This is an example of a pre-poll survey. A survey which is conducted much in advance. Mid-poll survey, which is now technically restricted, banned by Election Commission. And what is this mid-poll survey? Mid-poll survey is like in the case of Assam or West Bengal. It is an 8-phase poll. So earlier, say till 1998, what used to happen is that after every round of election, a poll used to come up. And the findings of the poll, exit poll, after every round of election was allowed to be shown to the people either through print media or electronic media. That has been banned now. You cannot do mid-poll. When the polling is in process, no poll. Polling means the voting is in process. It's the 8-phase poll in Bengal. So no opinion poll can be shown either on the TV or can be published in the print media during the entire period of 8 phases of election. So that's not happening now. People may be collecting data, but that cannot be made public. The data cannot be made public during the entire period of election. Exit poll. We all know exit poll is the big thing about election. This is the big show which takes place on the last day of polling. The last day of polling in Bengal is 29th of April, and on the evening, there is a ban up till, I think, 7 p.m. So election, no poll can come up till 7. So immediately after 7 p.m., you will see all television channels showing exit polls. So that's a very big exercise in opinion polls, in election, studying elections. And this poll is done generally on the election day, the voting day, and it is called exit poll because as voter exit the polling station, as soon as they come out of the polling station, normally they are asked few questions about which party they have voted for, prime chief ministerial choice, etc., etc. That is why it is called exit poll. And then there is another study called post poll. And the only difference between an exit poll and post poll is that there are other nuanced differences about, you know, inability and inability to do proper sampling, etc. But post-poll survey is done at least a day after polling is over, voting is over in a particular constituency or in a particular locality. So normally people will go to your house after the voting is over, day after that, and then sit at your house and ask detailed questions. That's post-poll survey. So these are different kinds of survey. And then model B is about continuous time series. And this has become very fashionable these days. Fashionable, and also there is a utility to that. People keep tracking at some interval. And the interval could be maybe week, could be 10 days, maybe monthly. So people keep doing surveys at some interval before the election to track how popularity of political parties are going up or going down, how popularity of political leaders are going up, going down, how are issues changing, etc. So this is continuous time series data. So you do surveys one after another. So this is about the timelines and the different models, duration of the survey. But in the middle, the blue dots, this is about what I discussed earlier also, the quantitative method. We do three kinds of data collection exercise: physical survey, CATI survey, and hybrid survey, which is a combination of CATI and physical survey. So now how quantitative research works, quantitative method of doing studying election, conducting face-to-face interviews using a pre-designed questionnaire. So in a quantitative method, it is important that a questionnaire, a pre-designed questionnaire, is used for conducting the data, collecting the data, because it is collected in very large numbers. So we can't have notepad, we can't record, because it has to be standardized, because interviews are to be, data is to be collected from few thousand people, maybe 5,000, maybe 50,000. There are different agencies, different people in this field now. People conduct very large samples, collect data from very large samples. At least we at CSDS don't collect data from a very large sample, because we collect data from relatively smaller sample compared to others. In Bengal, we are doing a post-poll survey, not on the polling day, but after the voting is over, and we are doing a survey of 5,000. But you would see on the 30th or 29th of April, people will come up with exit polls with maybe lakh or maybe more than a lakh data. But the important thing is that two things are important in quantitative method in the survey. A questionnaire has to be used in order to maintain standardization of collecting the information, and it should be done at multiple locations as far as possible. Jitna you spread it at different location, that's important, because spreading it out would mean getting opinion, collecting opinion from multiple locations of multiple people, multiple caste, multiple religion, multiple people from different age backgrounds, educational backgrounds. So it is possible to collect data from diverse population, and it is important because the voters are of diverse nature in terms of education, in terms of age, in terms of locality, etc. So that's very important in a quantitative method when we are doing the survey. So what is the advantage of a quantitative method and what is the limitation of a quantitative method? What is the advantage? Allows researcher to explain broader, larger perception on the issues, making generalized arguments. So when we collect using survey method, when the data is collected from large number of location, and this is the point which I mentioned earlier, it is important in a survey method, two things are extremely important. Data must be collected in large numbers. It should be collected from multiple locations, and large numbers and multiple locations allows or helps the researcher in collecting data of diverse population and as far as possible, a representative sample of the voters of that state or the country. So in Bengal, if we say roughly about 25 to 30% voters belong to the Muslim community. So this diversity would allow the researcher to collect data in which there would be 25 to 30% Muslim respondents. If women are 49% of the total voters or 50% of the total voters, this collecting data from multiple locations will facilitate similar proportion of women in the sample. And this will apply with regard to other variables, whether it is education, different caste, locality. And the other point is the data must be collected using a structured questionnaire. That structured questionnaire could be on the piece of paper, or it could also be on your computer, on your iPad, phone. Because these days we are using these app, people are using the app. So it is not necessary that the questionnaire must be on a piece of paper, but it could be on your phone also, and you can keep feeding it, but it has to be structured. So that's the advantage. Based on that, one can make generalization. And what is that generalization? And these are the generalization about which party is likely to win how many seats, which party is likely to get what percentage of votes, etc., etc. But there is a limitation. What is that limitation? It's very difficult to go into the details, the micro level analysis. What is happening in constituency A, or what is going to happen in constituency B? That it would be very difficult to explain these, or why people are not voting for party A and why one community of voters seems to be inclined to vote for party B. All these nuances cannot be explained through survey method. For that, it is important to do a qualitative method, maybe a case study, maybe detailed interviews of one particular community, one particular locality, to understand these nuances of the election. But if one has to generalize, and generalization generally about which party is likely to win how many seats, which party is likely to win to get what percentage of vote, this generalization can be done through a quantitative method, through survey, in a much better manner compared to any of the qualitative method of research. And you all will agree, this is so exciting for the voters of the state or the country. Everybody want to know well in advance who is winning, which, how many seats, what percentage of vote. People are not even excited about votes. People are only excited about numbers, that magic number, which party is likely to get how many seats. For that, it is the survey method which is most appropriate method of understanding elections. Now, as I said, we are not using any CATI or CAPI because we still use pen and paper. What is the possible disadvantage of using a CATI or a CAPI? There is a graph on a XY axis and there are number of states. Just to simply explain, what does it explain? The point I'm trying to make is that if you use CATI, which is computer assisted telephone interviews, or CAPI, computer assisted personal interviews, at least in CATI, what happens is that there is a difference in the exposure in the same age group of men and women. So in the same age group, let's take for between 18 and 30 years. In a particular state, the exposure of men and women in that same age group in a particular state is very different. The exposure of men to the technology, and when I say technology, it's about internet, it's about mobile phone, etc., is higher compared to women. So if we are using a CATI or a CAPI, the chances of women getting underrepresented in the sample is very high. And when we go and do face-to-face, this hurdle is overcome. So we can overcome this hurdle. And this graph explains the three states where the difference in terms of exposure for media, exposure for technology is least among men and women in the same age group is Manipur, Goa, and Kerala, which is on the extreme right. And if you look at the clustering on the left, which is group one, many states fall in that category. The point is, in many states, if you use CATI, the chances of underrepresentation of women is higher because in these states, even in the same age group, there is a difference in the level of exposure of men and women to technology. So the chances of women being underrepresented in the sample would be high. That is why still I think it is the best thing is to do pen and paper survey if we are doing election studies. Now I've been talking about two methods, quantitative method and a qualitative method. Question is, which is a better method? Answer is very simple. Depends upon what do you want to do with your election studies. If you want to come up with this magic number, which party is winning how many seats, then very simple, so is the best method. In order to come up with that magic number, and the magic number is which party is winning how many seats and which party is getting what percentage of votes. No, I think the best method is survey method. It falls into the category of a quantitative method. But if we are interested in the nuanced method, what is happening in constituency A or constituency B, why people are not voting for the same party in constituency A, even though the party is winning large number of seats in the entire state, what happened in that constituency? A constituency level study would be a very good technique to understand that, and then we should rely more on a qualitative method. So the answer to this question, which method is better? The answer to this question is depends. What do you want to study? What do you want to look at when you're trying to do an election study? If you want to know the numbers, survey method is the best method. If you want to know the nuances, why a particular community is voting the way they have voted, why young voters have not turned out to vote, a more nuanced study using a qualitative method would be better compared to a quantitative method. What are the shortcomings and what all phases of elections should be studied? I think I will take another 10 minutes, not more than that, 7-8 minutes. A length of the study. The election has become so keenly contested these days that in order to understand elections fully, it is important to cover, it is important to cover all the phases of elections in order to get a comprehensive sense of what happened in this election. Pre-election, what should one be doing? Voters are uninfluenced by parties in this phase since most campaign haven't begun. Good time to understand genuine performance of the incumbent. That's the time. Election has not been announced. That's the time people are not in that election frame. So if you want to understand, has the party really done good work on the ground? People are happy or unhappy. That's the best time to do an election study, election survey. Nomination process. This is the time to understand the strength and weakness of candidates. So parties apply social arithmetic to identify winnable candidates based on caste, religion, and other social groups. Good to time to observe local level conflict within the party. And this is the time when political parties engage in doing lots and lots of surveys, because they do the survey not to understand the nuances. This is the time they want to look at the winnable candidates, which candidate is popular and which candidate is not popular. So this is the time when political parties do lots and lots of election surveys. Campaigning. Now parties start organizing rallies and events to communicate their respective ideas. Good time to track leaders' popularity and poll issues. So the campaigning is going on. If you want to look at what are the issues, if political parties are interested in knowing what are the real issues, are issues which are flagged off in the manifesto the real issues of the voters on the ground or not, this is the time to do lots of studies to understand the leader's popularity, the poll issues, etc. Voting and the exit polls, as I said earlier also, the exit poll is done on the voting day. This is the day when voters are coming out of the polling station and the voters are being asked which party you have voted for, whom you would you like to see as the chief minister, etc., etc. This is the time to do exit poll results, and then we do our analysis and come with the conclusion. As I said, we must, in order to do a comprehensive study of elections, in order to understand elections in a most comprehensive manner, ideal situation is to do elections, or at least keep tracking elections in all the phases of elections. Now, moving on from the method to the second question, why should we attempt to understand elections? So this is now the first question. You remember I started with the two questions. How should we understand election and why should we understand election? So I am done with one part. How should we understand election? And I did mention about two methods, the qualitative method and the quantitative method. Now moving on from how should we understand elections to why should we understand election. And I would say I am just putting one opinion poll, exit poll data of the 2015 Bihar Assembly elections. And you get the answer that, oh, then if this is what is happening in election studies, then why should we study elections? And this is an example how horribly all the exit polls went wrong. This is, remember, 2015 assembly elections in Bihar, when JDU and RJD and Congress, all three parties came together, and BJP, Lok Jan Shakti Party and other smaller parties were together. The actual result is at the bottom. Actual result was JDU, RJD and INC got 178 seats. And BJP and its ally, LJP and others, got only 58 seats. And look at the forecast of, and this is based on the exit poll. Look at the forecast. People, all the agencies gave various kinds of forecast. And so we can keep reading. ABP News with AC Nelson, 130 seats for JDU, RJD Alliance. CNN IBN Axis My India 176 seats, and their final result was 178. But look at others, somebody giving 110, 80, 122, 132, and for NDA, the range is very high from 64 to 155. And finally, NDA ended up getting 58 seats. Most of the exit poll failed except one exit poll. And this is an example of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Out of these 8 exit poll, only one poll was up to mark and all other exit poll failed. So you might ask the question, what is the utility then? Why should we do an exit poll? What is the utility? Should we stop doing exit polls? Is election studies only for TRP or airtime for fun? My answer to that is no. This is one aspect of that. We should not confuse that election studies only about this number. The problem with election studies these days is that somebody studying election, so people would like to know, oh, what is your number? I may be studying elections for a different point of view. I want to understand the rallies. I want to understand do rallies, people who come to rallies actually turn into votes. So I may be having a different focus. I'm just looking at the women voters. Why they've suddenly started turning out to vote in such a large numbers. So I may be focusing on that. But when I say I'm studying elections, people would expect me to give this number. This is not the core of election studies. Yes, it has become a very important aspect these days for the TV, for the media, but this is not the only purpose which election studies serve. And this is connected to also, I said, we read the world wrong. Election studies is not only about numbers. It is much more than that. Pre-poll surveys which are conducted 2 months or 3 months before election, that does not tell you which party is going to win on the election day. It only gives us an indication of what is the mood of the people when the pre-poll was done in the month of December or January. But we read those opinion polls as truth. We think that this is going to be the result on the election day. So it's wrong reading. Most of the time, it is the wrong reading of the polls, and we think that the polls were wrong. Now, moving on to the last few slides about why, what is the utility of then election studies, the polls which are conducted, if you conduct the polls in a very systematic manner. And now this is based on the survey which we have been conducting at CSDS. These are all post-poll surveys based on this. And this is a very good example, not because my institute and I have been involved in these surveys, but this is an excellent example of doing polls systematically and trying to come up with nuanced analysis. You might say, what is nuanced in that? But look at the time series data to explain why BJP have suddenly become popular since 2014 election. Or if somebody asks this question, who are the voters who have shifted towards BJP between 2010 and 2019? So look at the findings of the data over a period of time. These are all in percentages. And this is how BJP has made inroads among the OBCs. And this is the national figure. These are all national elections, 96, 98, 99, 2004, 2009, 2014, and 2019. And look at the graph. BJP, if you look at up till 2009, almost there was a close competition between BJP and Congress with regard to the OBC vote. And you might wonder then what is happening to the rest of the OBC vote, because both of these parties together command only less than 50% vote. Rest of the 50% OBC votes gets distributed among the various regional party. And think of these regional party, two big regional party in Bihar, JDU and RJD, two big parties in UP, BSP and Akhilesh Yadav's Samajwadi party. And we can keep taking names of various regional parties which commands a lot of OBC vote. They have a very solid vote bank among the OBCs. But look at how BJP has made inroads. And this is from the, based on the survey, and that is why it is I'm coming with these numbers. If I had done a qualitative study, one of those methods, I would not have come up with these numbers. But these are based on very large scale surveys across the country, 20,000, 30,000 voters interviewed across the country, all the states at several locations. So look at the graph. BJP has made huge inroads among the OBC voters from 24%, 22% in 2009 to 34% and further to 44% in 2019. Upper caste consolidation. How upper caste have got consolidated in favor of BJP. 61% of the upper caste voted for BJP in 2019. They have always got sizable number of upper caste vote even in those elections which they lost, 2004 elections, 2009 elections. But still, BJP is the first choice of the upper caste voter, and this comes out from the various surveys which we have conducted. The Dalit vote, how BJP has been able to make huge inroads among the Dalits across the country. And look at the figures from 1996 till 2009, 12 to 14% Dalits voted for BJP nationally. 2004, it jumps from 12% to 24%, and in 2019, it further increases to 33%. Muslim vote. What is happening to the Muslim vote? Nationally, BJP gets roughly 7 to 8% Muslim vote. 2009 election is an exception when it dipped to 4%. What is happening to the Congress? Congress has lost a lot of Muslim vote, and over last, you know, 3-4 decades, it is almost about 38 to 40% Muslims have voted for the Congress. It dipped further in 2019 elections to 33%. And now Muslims, regional parties have become the first choice of the Muslim voters in many states. In all those states where a strong regional party is present, even if Congress is there. Only in the states where there is a bipolar contest between BJP and Congress, Congress gets roughly about 70 to 75% of the Muslim vote. And we know which are those states. Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Gujarat, etc., etc. But even in a state like Delhi, which for a very long time it was a bipolar contest, but as soon as Aam Aadmi Party came into being, Muslim vote has shifted in favor of Aam Aadmi Party in a big way. Similar things have happened in UP, West Bengal, Assam, in Bihar, etc. Just last two slides and I'm done with my presentation. Is it only about, you know, which caste has voted for which party? No, we can ask several questions to come up with very nuanced answer. These are all based on large scale survey. Just to give you a flavor or an idea about what all could be explained based on survey. Modi factor. There's a lot of talk about, is BJP about Modi? If an hypothetical question, if Modi is not the leader of BJP, what happens to BJP? So this is a question which we asked in 2019 elections. If Modi was not the prime ministerial candidate of BJP, would you still have voted for BJP, or you would have thought of changing your vote? Hypothetical question, but at least gives you some sense of how do the BJP voters feel about Prime Minister Narendra Modi's leadership. So this is among all those who voted for the BJP, and you remember BJP got 37% votes in 2019 elections. So the survey estimates suggest out of these 37% voters, among them 32% vote for of BJP is only and only because of Narendra Modi. So 32% of voters of the BJP, of those who voted for the BJP, they said, oh, if Prime Minister Narendra Modi was not the prime ministerial candidate of BJP, we would have thought of changing our voting preference. So in nutshell, I can say the rough estimate is of the 100 vote which BJP gets, approximately of the 10 votes which BJP gets, 3 is entirely coming because of Modi, because of Narendra Modi. So this is one way of assessing what is the impact of Prime Minister Modi for BJP's support base. And we get an evidence that of the 10 votes which BJP gets, 3 votes is only and only because of Narendra Modi. Balakot factor. There was a lot of discussion about, you know, did Balakot and Pulwama helped BJP in getting more seats? We have some evidence. If you look at the bar on the right hand side, heard about Balakot. So all those voters who heard about Balakot, 77% wanted Narendra Modi as the prime minister, and only 8% wanted to see Rahul Gandhi as the prime minister. And among those who had not heard about Balakot, and we should not be surprised that there are people in different remote villages who had not heard about Balakot. So among them, Prime Minister Modi's popularity was slightly less. From 77%, it was only 50%, and Rahul Gandhi's popularity was slightly higher. From 8%, it was 27% higher. It was 27%. So, from these findings, it gives us some idea that yes, Pulwama and Balakot incident did help in increasing Prime Minister Modi's popularity. Among those who had heard about this Balakot, the preference or the commitment for voting for Prime Minister Modi was much higher compared to those who had not heard about Balakot strike. So based on this study, based on the election study, based on the survey method which we employed, used, we do get a sense that Prime Minister Modi's contribution to BJP's vote share is, we get a number, roughly about 30%. We also get a number about what could be the extent. And these are estimates from survey. We cannot be sure about, when we say 77, we are not sure that it is only 77. It is in the range. It could be 75%. It could even be 79 or 80%. So we do get a sense that Pulwama and Balakot did help BJP in registering a much bigger victory compared to what may have happened if Pulwama Balakot incident has not taken place. So that's my last. That was my last slide. We can try and answer lots and lots of questions of that kind. Only if we had asked questions of those kind in our survey. And we keep asking lots and lots of questions in order to explain the outcome, what happened in this election, finally how people voted. And I've just shared some of the link where you can find many election studies, etc. And also mentioned the books, short, a small book which I have written, which is available on Kindle at zero cost. And I think this is available in three or four languages, Measuring Voting Behavior in India. We just explain, if you're interested in knowing in more detail, nuance, how do we prepare a questionnaire? How do you do the sampling to go to different, you know, locations? So I think I will stop here and would welcome as many questions as I can answer in the next, say, 35, 40, 45 minutes. I'm happy to spend more time with you. No problem. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sanjay.
Thank you, sir. Very useful
and conceptually very, you know, enriching paper. And I came as an illiterate person vis-a-vis election, but now I'll go out of this room with a lot of, you know, ideas, inputs from you. I'll just begin, you know, with three very simple questions, Sanjay, just to provoke you.
Yeah.
First question is that, you know, you talk about a quantitative survey where you will use questionnaire. Now, my question is, do you think when you apply a questionnaire to somebody who is educated and who is not, do you get different responses with regard to the level of education of the person being interviewed? That's one question. The second question, I mean, the methodology which you have talked about, do you think it's applicable to both the national and the regional elections, I mean, assembly elections I'm talking about? Because, you know, I think probably most of the data which you have referred to in your slides deal with the national election, the Lok Sabha poll. Yeah. But, you know, I just, since West Bengal election is taking place, I'm interested to know whether you will apply the same kind of methodology, you know, to arrive at a conclusion. And thirdly, I think, do you think Indian election, you know, I'll provoke you further, you know, given the application of the first past the poll system, the Indian election is not at all a democratic election. Because as you said, Modi won the election by with just 35% of the total votes. So 63% of the people didn't vote for Modi. So Modi is probably not democratically elected prime minister. I think the highest number of votes was received by Rajiv Gandhi, 44%. Still, you know, 56% people didn't vote for him or, you know, remained absent. So in that case, do you agree with the view that I think in India, we should have been better off with the application of proportional representation rather than first past the poll system? These are three questions. I mean, you can take the question and the answer later at one go. Or if you want to answer one by one, you can do that. That's it. And then we'll have questions, you know.
I think I should try and respond to these three questions first, and then I can take questions in batches and then respond. Okay. First, survey method, when we use questionnaire, so we have people asking the question. And we should expect not a huge difference when we are talking to an educated person or an uneducated person. But still, we find differences. The no opinion goes up when we are talking to an uneducated person on many questions. We were talking about, if we are asking some nuanced question about coalition, etc. So the no opinion goes up. Sometimes even on questions like, you know, who would you like to see as the prime minister? Who would you like to see as the chief minister, next chief minister? Very uneducated old people would tend to, some of them tend to say, pata nahi, how do I say, ami kuch kichi janu nahi in Bangla. So it happens. But if you meet an educated person, sometimes they would try and interview you first rather than giving an interview. So there are some differences. One has to work in the through that model. A national versus state election. Yes, the same template we apply for national and for the state assembly election. I was very conscious about not putting up any slide about the 4-5 states. I could do that once elections are over. I can have another lecture trying to analyze the verdict of West Bengal and in a time series data if you want. But I thought because of the election commission restriction, I should not be saying anything specific about West Bengal or Assam or any other state. Election process is on. But the same kind of presentation could be done or in a more nuanced manner for any particular state. The same template is applied. The question of vote share and the seat. And you ended with the question, if we had applied not the FTPT, first past the post system, but a proportional representation, things would have been different, or would we have been in a better political situation or political climate? See, ifs and buts, very difficult. I don't know, we maybe, if we had applied, suppose a proportional representation system, maybe in today's lecture, we would have been discussing the difficulties or the minus points in proportional representation. Who knows? So I think no system, no electoral system is foolproof. There would be limitations, there would be advantage and disadvantages. But just to give you an example of discrepancy, how it works, yes, some changes I think is desirable. We have to, maybe people need to think more carefully about that. A mixed kind of a method, like we have in a country like even our neighboring country, Nepal, they have a mixed method. So look at the discrepancy. If you look at 2019 Lok Sabha elections, there are elections when a party has got less vote and more seats. Karnataka, the example is from Karnataka, and a party has got more votes but less seats in the assembly. Also look at the other example. BJP got 18.6% vote nationally in the 2019 Lok Sabha elections, and BJP managed to win 116 Lok Sabha seats. 2014 Lok Sabha elections, same country, same electorate, same party, Congress gets 19.6% votes. Congress vote share is 1% higher compared to BJP's vote share in the previous election. But look at the number of seats. BJP got 116 Lok Sabha seats based on 18.6% vote. Congress ends up getting only 44 seats, even though the vote share was 1% higher in this election compared to the previous election. There are many discrepancies of this kind. Vote share, vote and seat ratio is not the same in different elections. It varies even in the state from one election to another, and it varies from one state to another in a very huge manner.
So next question, please. Thank you, sir, for your nice response. Now let me, sir, bring to your attention 4-5 questions from my colleague Dr. Kaushik Ghosh, who is very keen to know from you that what is your opinion on NOTA, N-O-T-A, none of the above. Sir, second question is, according to him, there is a minimum qualification for the candidates. What is your opinion? I mean, any candidate, those who are going to fight for voting as a candidate, what will be their qualification? And third question is, now the second phase of corona has already started. Is this the right situation to continue the election? And fourth is the pre-poll, exit poll before election is hampered amongst the mind of the voters? And last and final question is, now election strategist is a new job opportunity in the market.
What is your opinion, sir?
Setting election strategy.
Yes. Election strategist is a new job opportunity in the market. What is your opinion? So these five questions.
Something short.
Yeah. So first on the NOTA, we have done a major project on NOTA for Election Commission of India, and I will just summarize the summary. My own sense is that NOTA, people who are voting for NOTA, is not a nuanced vote of rejection of a candidate or a political party. It is more or less synonym to what we used to have, a rejected vote. And why do I say that? If it is a nuanced vote, we should expect NOTA to be higher in those constituencies where there are more educated voters compared to uneducated voters. But the relationship is very strange. And I will just highlight this. The relationship is that the constituency which has higher number of uneducated voter NOTA is high, is higher. And this is not based on one election or one state. This is based on large number of elections and multiple states. So the NOTA is higher in those constituencies where the proportion of uneducated voters are higher. NOTA is higher in those constituencies which is more rural compared to urban. NOTA is higher in those constituencies where SC and ST proportion, people, voters belonging to SC and ST community are higher. These are indications, and we did ask very specific questions about voting NOTA. All these indicate that if it is a nuanced vote, it should have been the other way around. More educated people should have been voting more for NOTA because if it is a vote, conscious vote of rejection, that's not happening. So NOTA is still to make an impact. It is just a vote of mistake. People are not very, very little idea about what is NOTA. Very few of them are actually pressing NOTA because at the elections, many states have this provision that certain degree of education is required. I am not in favor of that because as soon as we start doing that, then we are negating the chances of large number of people in India who are uneducated. If we reach that situation, if we are able to educate everyone, then maybe that would be the situation maybe the time when we could think of providing an educational qualification for the candidate. Corona, second phase of Corona. See, if you are trying to cross a river and you are in the middle of the river, and when you started, the river was cool and calm. All of a sudden, there is a huge wave in the river. What do you do? Do you jump out of the boat? We don't jump out of the boat. We somehow try and take the boat on the side. There may be disaster, but there is a possibility that we will be able to take the boat on the side. We are in the middle of the election cycle. What do you do? What does the election commission do? Should we stop election in West Bengal? Only three phases have been completed. So I think it's a catch-22 situation. One is in the middle of election and one has to try and, complete the process. Pre-poll, minds of the voter. This is a question, does it influence the minds of the voter? I keep encountering this question in many places, and wherever I am meeting face to face, and if it is a gathering of 50, 100 people, and I would ask this simple question. So how many of you change your voting intention or make up your mind of voting after looking at a pre-poll survey? And nobody in the gathering would say, no, I got influenced. The tendency is that we all think we are very clever. We don't get influenced by opinion poll. Others are getting influenced by opinion polls. And everybody is thinking in that manner. I am not getting influenced. Others are getting influenced. So I am not saying that it has no impact. It does make some impact sometimes. But on the both side, some people don't want to waste their vote. So they would like to vote for the party which is seen as winning, what we call the bandwagon effect. There are also people, voters, who don't want to vote for the winning party, and they think that they should support the party which is not seem does not seem to be doing well. So some voters also side with what we call underdog effect. It cancels out, both the trends cancels out each other. So the point is, it does not make such a huge impact, but the utility of pre-poll survey is to flag the issues. What do people want? What are the issues? Election strategies. Yes, it has become a big, it has become a good career prospect, because election strategies are not only being recruited these days by political parties only at the time of election. We have seen political parties or the government which has to face elections. Now, you took the name of Prashant Kishore. Even before the elections are over in West Bengal, he has been hired by the Punjab government, you know, the Congress party. The chief minister has already engaged him for consultancy in Punjab. So yes, but you have to be really, really skilled. Everybody is not Prashant Kishore. There are a lot of people in this field, but how many names do we know? We only know the name of Prashant Kishore. Maybe one or two if you are in this field. But you have to be really good if you want to make a career in this.
But you know, Sanjay, with regard to Prashant Kishore, he didn't succeed everywhere. I mean, look at the Bihar election. There, you know, his calculations didn't went wrong, right?
I agree that he did not succeed in every state, every election. That applies to everyone. Sachin Tendulkar did not score a century in every match. Sunil Gavaskar, the great batsman of our times, did not score a century in every match. He did score some zeros. He did score some centuries. Sometimes he got out at 20 and sometimes at 82. That happens with in every profession. We don't deliver as a professional, as a professor. I don't think I am able to deliver the same kind of a lecture to all the audience. Sometimes on some odd day, I am very odd. Some day, I am just okay.
Yeah, I understand.
Yeah. Okay, sir. Then one more, two more questions from our dean, Institute of Social Science. In local, it is Principal Vidyabhavan, Professor Sarvajit Sengupta. He actually, sir, wants to know from you that if some people do not respond to the survey and we leave them out of the data, should we not consider why they did not respond? This is the first question, sir. Then second question, how large is the problem when some people do not state their true preferences, particularly when their opinion is at odds with most people in their neighborhood community? Two questions.
So both questions are related to the field work technique. Let me pick up the second question first. And that is why, second question, how do we know that the person who has responded to the voting question, he has responded faithfully and in a correct manner? Is he deceiving the researcher? It is quite possible. And maybe many of the opinion polls or many of the exit poll, when they are going wrong, maybe this is happening because the voting question is being asked at the polling station, and polling stations on the election day are normally crowded. And if you ask the voting question, which party you have voted for on the polling station, where a lot of people are around, maybe people are not telling you the truth. So it is important to try and maintain secrecy of voting. Try and give the person confidence that the response which he is giving is not known to others who are present there, also to the investigator who is asking that question. And at least I can tell you that is the reason why we are not using telephone as the mode for survey. We are using pen and paper, and what we do, we use a dummy ballot paper and a dummy ballot box. It is tedious, it requires a lot of effort. So what we would do for asking the voting question, we hand over that ballot paper, a dummy ballot paper, to the people, to the respondent whom we are interviewing, and we are not doing the exit poll on the polling station. We are at his house. And then we ask that person to put a mark on the party symbol which he or she has voted. Don't show it to others. Don't show it to me. And just put it in the box. We have a small box which we would carry, our people would carry, just to ensure, just to make the respondent comfortable that his response is not known to others, his response is not known to the person who is asking the question. We try our best. I don't believe that large number of people are telling you a lie. If
other problem, huh?
Reality. So both things are happening. So it should be, the effort should be to try and maintain, try to ask the voting question in such a way that the secrecy of the vote is maintained. Now when people don't respond, first the proportion of people not responding to the survey, we might think sitting in Calcutta or sitting in Delhi that kisko samay hai, who has the time to give you response. That's not the situation. Yes, in the urban area, it has started becoming slightly difficult because people don't give you time. But go to the rural India and still, you know, India is 70% rural. So we don't have difficulty in collecting data in the rural India. You are welcome. People give you time. People speak to you. In our urban India, it has started becoming difficult, sometimes difficult. And we do try and collect information about why we don't begin the survey without asking a question on the consent. If the people don't give us consent, we don't interview that person. So we try and get an answer why this person was not interviewed. So we try and so that we can build upon that information for our future surveys. How do we, in order to strategize our data collection methods.
Thank you, sir. Then one more question from our colleague, Dr. Adani Loco, Department of Botany.
Okay.
Does voting nota have any hidden message trying to convey to the political parties or party?
As I said, I don't see nota as a vote of dissent. It is not a very clear vote of dissent. So the message political parties, first, why political parties are not taking it seriously, because the proportion of people voting for nota is very low. Also, political parties do have people on the ground. They also interact with the people. And I think they are also getting the sense that people are not taking nota seriously. It is not a vote, nuanced vote of rejecting the candidate. There is no even one constituency where nota is very high. So political parties are yet to take it seriously. I think if nota provisions are made more strict, in a sense, suppose certain percentage of nota might result in disqualification of the election or countermanding of election. I'm just saying hypothetically, if some string is attached to that, then only political parties will take it seriously. In the current situation, hypothetically, if there are 100 voters in a constituency, even if 99 vote for nota and one voter vote in favor of a particular party, that party candidate will get elected, and 99 people who have voted for nota, their vote will not be of any use. Their opinion will not be of any use. So parties will take nota seriously only if there is a string attached to that. There is an outcome if people vote for nota. At the moment, there is no outcome.
Thank you, sir. Then another question. Does identity politics surpasses development in a state with large variation in demography?
See, both the things are not just opposed to each other. It's not that if you have diverse population and if a party or a government is engaged with doing identity politics, the party cannot simultaneously do development. It is quite possible that both the things can go hand in hand, side by side. I don't see both the things contradicting each other or going in different direction. That if you want to do development, then the party has to keep itself away from identity politics, or vice versa. If you want to do identity politics, because identity politics will also be in the name of developing certain community, certain groups, etc. So these are not standing against each other. Both of these can go together if political parties or the government want to do that.
Okay, sir. Then this happens to be the last question from participant side, Professor Devasis Sarkar from Agricultural Science. How do you build rapport with the respondents which is necessary for survey research? Is there any technique? This is his question.
No, there is no specific technique. It is not like having a headache and then you take a medicine and your headache will come down. It's like, you know, in the present context, I would say it's like corona. Very difficult to figure out how it is spreading. You know, in spite of all the precautions, people are getting affected. People have not come out of their house. Nobody has come out of the house and then still people are getting infected. And look at the kind of big rallies which are taking place in all the five states which went to poll. Look at the farmers' agitation which is going on in Delhi. Lots and lots of people gathered at one place and we don't come across corona cases. So the point I'm trying to make is that very difficult to say this is the way to establish a rapport with the respondent. There are few tips, and the tips which we give to our investigator, don't tell a lie. If the interview requires 25 to 30 minutes, don't tell him that I need only 5 minutes. Don't give any false promises that, you know, once you do my interview, give me the interview, I will be able to get these things fixed for you or for your village. Normally, if you go to people, will say, ration card nahi hai, mera ye nahi hai, can you help me in getting these things done for me? No false promises. And it is very important to establish your neutrality. You should not be seen as favoring a political party or you have come from any political party. So what we try and do is to, we give certain, some documents to the investigator if it is required. I know that there are many people who are uneducated. What do they do with these documents? So identity card, letters, etc., establishing the neutrality. But finally, it is about the conversational mode. If you are able to, you know, establish your a good rapport through conversation, that's enough.
Thank you, sir. Sir, I think you will not mind if I ask one more question, which have been posted by one of our colleagues, Dr. Sukumar Pal from Department of Social Work. He has two questions. Why booth capturing is still taking place? How do you predict result in such a context?
Why booth capturing is still taking place? Bengal has gone, three phases of polling has been over in Bengal, the entire in Assam, Tamil Nadu, etc., etc. Get a sense at how many polling stations voting has already taken place. And do we have any data how many polling stations have been captured? And what do we mean by capturing a polling station? You know, in such a large country, first let me say, in such a large country, in such a diverse population, you know, one or two things might, at least in the present day context, I'm saying, I'm not talking about India of the 90s or the 80s, when election used to be very violent in Bihar, in eastern UP and many parts, where it used to be booth capturing. And booth capturing means few people sitting at the booth, not allowing anyone to come to that polling station and casting all the votes themselves. 2, 3, 4, 5 people of one community or one political party. That's booth capturing. That it has been captured by few people and others are not allowed to come and cast the vote. That's booth capturing. How many places this kind of a thing is taking place these days? Very rare, very rare. There are different kinds of complaints about what is happening in different polling stations. There may be complaints. Even those complaints are negligible compared to large number of polling stations at which polling has already taken place. And I'm just referring to the current round of, present round of assembly elections. So that's about booth capturing. How do we predict in such a context? It's easy because it's not taking, booth capturing is not taking place in majority of the places. It may be one in, you know, few hundred. And if we are collecting the data from large number of localities, as I mentioned, that survey method requires collecting data through a structured questionnaire and large sample, and these samples should be spread as far as possible. If it is taking place at one place, it's okay, that's fine. If there is a water problem, if the water is not coming in one locality in the city of Delhi, we don't say that the entire city's tap are dry, the city is not getting water. People in other parts do their routine, lead their routine life. So that's about booth capturing and how do we take into account when we are making prediction, even if some booth has been captured.
So thank you, sir. I think we have no more question for you, and we are very pleased for your illustrious presentation and of course interesting interaction, and you have very nicely respond to all the questions. And before handing over to the microphone to our Vice Chancellor for offering formal word of thanks and concluding remarks, let me just have your permission, sir. Usually through this online lecture, we have just make it video, and in our library YouTube channel, we need to upload these things because this kind of illustrious lecture is going to disseminate to all of our fraternity, not only Visakhapatnam, not only Bengal, rather India and abroad too. So I think you will allow us to do it.
Yeah, you have my consent for that. No problem.
Okay, thank you, sir. May I now request our honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, to offer formal word of thanks and concluding remarks, sir. Please.
Sanjay, first of all, you know, I am really very, very happy to be able to listen to you because of two things. One, that you have really become a true cephalologist and with, you know, recognition by so many of the experts in election studies all over the world, because you have been highly cited, you have been highly quoted, and I am told that you are sought after as a speaker. I mean, that part I didn't know because I am really listening to you formally today. So I think, you know, the last part I had some doubts, but today after having listened to you, I think that doubt is just has evaporated. And now as you gave a commitment to us that after the election you will come back to Vishwabharati and give a kind of presentation on the analysis of the election results. And I think, you know, I normally do an essay on, you know, this kind of stuff. And there I also would like to take your help. And also I'd like to listen to you very, very seriously to be enriched on this aspect of electoral studies. That's one. And second thing, you know, Sanjay, the sort of work which you have started is very useful. And I just would like to make a request, don't be a kind of formal strategist so that you will be hired by the politicians and will not get your, you know, inputs. So please remain as an academic so that we who are interested in election studies, and I'm sure generation ka baat main nahi kar raha hun, you know, the next generation after next, you know, सभी लोग उपस्थित होंगे अगर आप जैसे टीचर हो. इसलिए माय रिक्वेस्ट यू नेवर एवर बिकम एन इलेक्शन स्ट्रेटजिस्ट लाइक प्रशांत किशोर. प्रॉब्ली यू बी मोर इफेक्टिव एंड यू विल अर्न मोर देन प्रशांत किशोर. बट माय रिक्वेस्ट यू, आई थिंक इट्स अ काइंड ऑफ कमांड टू यू एज ए टीचर, दैट प्लीज डोंट लीव द प्रोफेशन व्हिच यू हैव टेकन बिकॉज यू आर एक्चुअली कॉन्ट्रीब्यूटिंग टू अ पर्टिकुलर एरिया ऑफ नॉलेज अबाउट व्हिच we are not really, we don't get many experts, you know. Now I think you are the only one who does this thing so seriously, and you are taken so seriously by all the experts. And most of those who work on elections, they draw on the data which you collect on behalf of Lokpriti. So I think my request to please remain where you are. And you know, as I said, on behalf of Vishwabharati, I thank you personally. I mean, here I'm playing a very formal role, but as I said, as you said also, as soon as you receive an email or any intimation from me, you readily agree. So I'm sure I'll continue to have that kind of right over you. So whenever, you know, I need you, you know, just to enlighten my colleagues, enlighten my students, and of course enlighten me, I'll keep on bothering you. And दिल्ली में कोरोना बहुत बढ़ रहा है, थोड़ा ध्यान रखना. संभाल के रहना, और दिल्ली में मेरा जितना दोस्त है सबको मेरा सलाम दे देना, एंड बेस्ट ऑफ लक टू यू संजय, एंड आई विश यू ऑल द बेस्ट। मैं भगवान को प्रार्थना करता हूँ आप आगे बढ़ो, और जो काम आप कर रहे हो ये काम में बिल्कुल यू गो टू द पीक ऑफ द